Live from Broadcasting House. This is KBC Prime Edition. Good evening. My name is Tom Boyer. We have a lot of stories lined up for you tonight, coming off the back of an interview of the Azimio duo, Right Honorable Raila Odinga and his running mate Martha Karua, that was televised jointly by media houses. Our reporter Nancy Okware sat on the panel of the interviewers, and we will later on be looking at what areas were covered during that conversation. But let's first look at our top stories tonight. Kenya Kwanza Coalition intensifies economic forums ahead of the launch of its manifesto. Raila Odinga takes his presidential campaigns to Narok, assuring the Maa community of benefit from the Maasai Mara Reserve. And Usawa Kwa Wote Party leader Mwangi Wa Iria seeks the Chief Justice intervention in his presidential candidacy row with IEBC. Thank you very much indeed for joining us. Our socials are at KBC Channel 1, my Twitter handle at TomBoyer24, and the hashtag is Prime Edition. Now, Azimio la Umoja presidential candidate Raila Odinga and his running mate Martha Karua, as I indicated a little while ago, held a news conference at Raila's current residence. The duo fielded questions from journalists from various media houses hinged on the party's manifesto, Raila saying that he will go into the election with an open mind. I indicated to you that our colleague Nancy Okware sat on that panel, and a little later on we hope to get you something more comprehensive, so stay with us on that. Now, moving on, the United Democratic Alliance presidential running mate Rigathi Gachagua says that their administration's first priority is to improve the economy. Speaking in Laikipia during a consultative economic forum, Gachagua promised to end what he claimed was state capture of the economy if Kenya Kwanza forms government after the August 9th general election. Kenya Kwanza Alliance, which is on a race to conclude on the economic forums ahead of the manifesto launch on the 30th of June, also had other leaders hold separate forums in three other different counties. Here is that report.
The Kenya Kwanza Brigade leaders on Tuesday ran separate consultative economic forums with electorates in the counties of Turkana, West Pokot, Kitui, and Laikipia, collecting views on issues affecting residents.
Bottom up.
The United Democratic Alliance presidential running mate Rigathi Gachagua led the vote hunting mission in Laikipia County, accompanied by Laikipia Senator John Kinyua.
Is regarding the NU in Abuja. It is your government. Nadio mimi niko hapo. Hata kama ninasaidia William Ruto kuongoza Kenya, si mnajua bahali yangu iko? Si mnajua? Iko hapa.
A meeting that saw residents cite challenges facing them, top on the list being insecurity.
Siku ya leo itaandikwa katika kumbukumbu za historia kwa sababu shida zetu za Laikipia zimeandikwa vizuri, hasa mambo ya usalama, mambo ya title deed.
One assurance nikiwa hapa Laikipia. Mambo ya watu kuwawa na kupigwa Laikipia tukichaguliwa, it is a thing of the past. It will never happen. Ever happen.
A different team led by ANC party leader Musalia Mudavadi, accompanied by Amason Kingi and Alfred Mutua, wooed voters in Kitui County, assuring them of the alliance commitment to address their concerns.
Ikiwa tunataka tujikomboe kwa shida hii ya kiuchumi, ni lazima sasa tuweke serikali ambayo itazingatia uchumi.
Hatuwezi kuleta ruwaza ama manifesto ya Kenya pasipo kumuhusisha Mkenya mwenyewe.
Moses Wetangula, Joseph Atnanok and Aden Duale drummed up support for the alliance bottom-up economic model in Turkana County.
Ukiniuliza mimi, kwa miaka 16 ya maisha yangu ya kwanza sikuwa na kiatu. Tunajua, tunaelewa inayomfinya mwananchi wa kawaida.
Mukipata kiti, tafadhali sana mtukumbuke kama wamama. Kwanza, tunataka kuimprove ile hatchery system. ya kuproduce vifaranga na vifaranga kwa mama wafuge, wakifuga, wauze.
The alliance is racing against time to conclude the economic forums ahead of its manifesto launch on 30th of June. Kamche Menza for Prime Edition.
Well, earlier on, before appearing on a live interview that was televised jointly by various media houses, Azimio la Umoja One Kenya Coalition flag bearer Raila Odinga vowed to protect the Maasai Mara National Reserve as well as the Mau complex against encroachment and personal interests. Campaigning in Narok, Raila assured the Mau community of enhanced benefits from the game reserve if he wins the presidential election. Gishuki Washira reports.
Former Prime Minister returned to Narok County to popularize his presidential bid at a time communities living around the Maasai Mara National Reserve are lamenting reduced benefit from the resource. The Azimio la Umoja One Kenya flag bearer committing to protect the Mara National Reserve and Mau complex against land grabbing.
Mau tutazidi kulinda Mau na kuhifadhi Mau kwa manufaa ya kizazi hichi na ile ambayo inakuja. Sawa. Pili, mambo ya Maasai Mara. Maasai Mara vilevile tutahifadhi. Wale ambao wanataka kuiba mali ya Maasai Mara wambia
ODM's Narok gubernatorial candidate Moitalel Ole Kenta pledged to reform the revenue collection system at the game reserve as well as restore the Mau complex.
In this county, we have had looters coming from outside, looting and taking away all our resources. Sasa hiyo itakwisha. Mambo ya Maasai Mara itakuwa kazi ya watoto wetu. Hii ni mali waliachiwa na baba yao. Hakuna mtu tena ataingia Mara na 70 ama 80% ya wafanyikazi wa Mara watakuwa jamii ambao sio wa Mara.
The Azimio la Umoja team rallied the Narok electorate to turn up on 9th August and elect leaders of integrity.
Wamasai hawa ni watu ambaye ni wafugaji wa ng'ombe. Ile jambo ambaye mimi ningeomba ni kwamba wakati utachukua kiti kama president wa Kenya, hawa Wamasai ushughulikie hao kwa market ya ng'ombe yao kwa sababu ile nyama ambayo inauzwa.
Tumesema wakati huu tarehe 9 mwezi wa 8 tutasema baba atakuwa ni Raila Amolo Odinga. Wangapi wanasema baba anaenda sasa?
Gishoki Washira, Prime Edition.
Into the corridors of justice, Murang'a County Governor Mwangi wa Iria is pleading with Chief Justice Martha Koome to intervene in the ongoing standoff with the Independent Electoral and Boundaries Commission. The Usawa Kwa Wote party leader believes that the matter is no longer a legal tussle but an administrative issue. Wa Iria was barred by IEBC from contesting the presidential election after he failed to meet the requisite qualifications. Serafina Robi reports.
In a letter written to the Chief Justice Martha Koome, the Usawa Kwa Wote leader Mwangi wa Iria outlines the alleged injustices he suffered in his quest for clearance to vie for the presidential seat.
To Chepukati, but Chepukati decided to terminate my process unduly, without reasoning to me, while at the same time he gave every other candidate an opportunity.
His case against the Independent Electoral and Boundaries Commission was set for hearing on the 27th of June, but the commission asked the judge to recuse himself. The case was hence referred to the principal judge for directions, but the judge is currently away from office.
It's exactly 1 month, 30 days, since I started engaging judiciary on this matter. I have never been heard. Every time we go, we are given stories. 1 month. Every other electoral matter is being heard within days. So Chepukati did not hear me. The court has not heard me.
Well, with less than 40 days remaining to the 9th August general elections, the Usawa Kwa Wote party leader Mwangi wa Iria can now only hope that with the whistle having been blown, his leg will be untied, as he alleges, so that he can be allowed to vie for the top seat in the country. Serafina Robi for Prime Edition.
28 September 2012.
Meanwhile, Justice Mugure Thande has...
Now, the Azimio la Umoja presidential candidate Raila Odinga and his running mate Martha Karua a little while ago held a news conference at Raila's current residence. The duo fielded questions from journalists, including our very own Nancy Okware, and the issues hinged around the party's manifesto. Raila says that he will go into the election with an open mind. Let's now look at that report.
On how to go about things, that's supposed to be settled in the boardroom. We will try to conduct ourselves in a way that maintains the respect of the office and demonstrates respect to the people of Kenya.
You need to work together closely with the devolved units and agree on priorities. And also you must have a benchmark through which performance of the counties can be measured. You see, so that you have equal system of service. You know, you have a situation where other countries do so well in health systems, others do better in education facilities, others in water, and other. We must have one country. We must have a way of measuring performance of county government, and that is the responsibility of the national government.
Well, that was the interview of the Azimio duo, Right Honorable Raila Odinga and his running mate Martha Karua, a little while ago, that was televised jointly by media houses across the country. Let's go to Portugal now. President Uhuru Kenyatta has called for urgent global action to address challenges facing oceans, seas and marine environment, saying that the world needed to upgrade from proposals on the subject to tangible interventions. Speaking in Lisbon, President Kenyatta said that time has come for world leaders to work together and address that question. Let us now look at that report in great detail.
President Uhuru Kenyatta, who co-chaired the opening plenary session of the second United Nations Ocean Conference with President Marcelo Rebelo de Sousa of Portugal and UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres in Lisbon, Portugal, called on world leaders to shift gears from proposals to action in tackling challenges facing oceans and maritime ecosystems.
The burden of choice lies with each and every one of us. Over the last decade, we have accumulated sufficient knowledge of all the risks and opportunities and deepened our understanding of actions that we should take.
The head of state pointed out that two-thirds of global waters lie in areas beyond national jurisdictions, ABNJ, of economic exclusive zones, noting that inaction in one sea affects other seas, adding that oceans were the most underappreciated resource in the world despite their centrality to human existence.
Most of us do not comprehend just how central the ocean is to human existence. And for this, let me just cite a few examples which underscore why we are in this meeting today. Our oceans cover 70% of the global surface, and 3 billion people depend on marine and coastal biodiversity.
President Kenyatta said that human action continue to put ocean systems under immense stress, especially from indiscriminate dumping of plastic waste, pointing out that more than 8 million tons of plastics are thrown into oceans each year.
Human action has put ocean systems under immense stress. We dump more than 8 million tons of plastics into the oceans each year, sickening and contaminating at least 700 species of marine life.
With concrete promises and binding promises coming from every continent.
The president noted that solutions to the challenges facing oceans lie with the people, saying that if managed sustainably, maritime resources are able to produce as much as 6 times more food and generate 40 times more renewable energy.
It is our expectation, therefore, that this conference will shift gear from proposals to action. Action that is driven by science, technology, and innovation.
For Prime Edition, I'm Ben Troyenjua.
Excellency President Uhuru Kenyatta speaking from Lisbon in Portugal. That report brings us to our first break. Is the price of unga going up? Find out when we come back. Stay with us.
Every day, over 15 million members are transforming Africa.
Get John chapter 11 as your skiza tune, dial *811*965#.
I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. John chapter 11, verse 25.
To get John chapter 11, dial *811*965#. To get John chapter 11, dial *811*965#.
Do you have a new story to share with KBC? Get in touch swiftly on email news@kbc.co.ke or call 0723-892-654 or 0734-780-124.
And entertainment industry has evolved over the years.
It is at such times that our destinies are written. Will we rise up in courage or die in cowardice?
Who are the movers and shakers in film and theater? Get trendy as we review locally produced films and stage drama every Wednesday at 9 p.m. on Cinemas and Theater.
Brought to you by the Kenya Film Commission. Film Kenya, capture Africa.
With less than 2 months remaining to August 9th, battle lines have been drawn in Kakamega County, with candidates receiving clearance from the IEBC to vie for the seat. This Thursday, 30th June, tune in to KBC Channel 1 from 9:50 p.m. for a live gubernatorial debate and get to know each candidate's development agenda for Kakamega County.
Our socials at KBC Channel 1, my Twitter handle at TomBoya24, hashtag Prime Edition, the cost of maize. Flour may soon go down. Some good news after the government scrapped all charges and levies to maize imported in the country. The move now opens the way for over 200 trucks carrying maize from Malawi, Tanzania and Zambia, which were stuck at the Namanga border point. Government made the decision after wide consultations with key stakeholders and the acute maize shortage in the country.
The retail price of maize flour had risen to a record high, with a 2-kilo packet crossing the 200 shillings mark. Kenyans were bracing for a further spike as maize imported from Tanzania, Malawi and Zambia destined for Kenya was stuck at the Namanga border post due to the paperwork issues. Better days may be in the offing as the government has now resolved the paperwork at the Namanga border. Speaking at the Namanga one-stop border, Agriculture Cabinet Secretary Peter Munya said the measure has been prompted by the increased prices of unga that is adversely affecting households. Munya says the scrapping of duty for maize importation is geared towards empowering private importers to import sufficient maize in the country and cut millers' cost of production.
We have decided that we will suspend all levies and charges imposed on maize imported into the country, even as we wait for the other maize that millers were authorized to import from various destinations that was duty-free, which is likely also to arrive. This measure is intended to reduce the costs of maize that is coming into the country and therefore impact on the price of maize and unga that is increasing in our retailing points across the country.
The shortage has further been exacerbated by farmers who hoard their produce anticipating a further increase in prices. The CS warned the farmers that they risk incurring losses once the prices come down.
We are also asking those who are holding maize, because we know there are people and individuals holding maize, when this cheap maize comes, don't complain. Don't complain, because they'll start complaining that their prices have gone down.
He said the taxes scrapping will be gazetted on the 1st of July and it will be effective for the next 90 days. Reporting for Prime Edition, I am Teresa Mutai.
For Kenyans, there's a cost of unga, the staple food, going down. It's now time for business, and I understand that we are getting more players in the energy sector. I don't know how that will affect the general price level. Obra.
Well, absolutely. I mean, you got it right. Look here. I mean, when you look at, Kenya's electricity mix, you have solar, you have thermal, you have hydro, you have geothermal, which is actually a lot of it actually. And then when you look at solar energy in Kenya, we are yet to harness the power of solar energy. And when you consider the fact that significant portion of our land would be considered to be arid and semi-arid, whereby you have 356 or 65 days of an interrupted solar supply, you realize that we are doing badly. But we are seeing some deliberate efforts by the government to try and tap into these tremendous energy. And so that's why more players have been licensed to offer solar energy, you know, as an alternative to electricity, to geothermal, to hydro, you know, to thermal power. So you expect a lot of people using around the far-flung areas of our country, you know, to be connected to the national grid going forward.
Good preamble. Take it away.
Absolutely. Thank you. Well, access to solar lighting product is set to ease following the entry of 14 more solar companies under the second phase of the Kenya Off-Grid Solar Access Project, COSAP. The 390 million shillings project aims at increasing uptake of solar home systems across 14 counties considered to be off-grid.
More households and businesses in Kenya are embracing solar energy to either supplement electricity supply from the national grid
or for their energy needs. This is on account of high cost of electricity, or in some cases, erratic supply from the national grid, which has favored solar energy.
I want you also to know that solar has really not become a very easy thing in this country, whereas countries like Morocco, countries like the Arab United Emirates, their tariff on solar stands at about 1.5 to 2. The tariff for solar in this country is 12. And that's why then it's not so much of an easy venture. And that's why we really must also find a way in which we can actually be able to ensure that the solar component, because there is modernization, and the prices for the solar should be coming down.
This has led to the growth of the commercial photovoltaic system marketplaces, with sales estimated to be between 25,000 and 30,000 photovoltaic modules made yearly, and 102 megawatts of utility solar installed. To further boost access to solar home systems, the government, in partnership with the Balbank and Dutch energy firm SNV, has rolled out the second phase of Kenya's off-grid solar access project, COSAP.
And for clean cooking has been to reach 2.5 million people reaching access to clean cooking, and 1.9 million people gaining access to off-grid solar.
This round, we are really encouraging that the companies really focus on involvement of local last mile entrepreneurs in this particular implementation.
Under the project, 390 million shillings will be shared out among 14 firms that have been selected to undertake the supply and distribution of solar equipment across 14 counties under the COSAP project.
And of course, the 14 countries, as you will bear with me, the West Pokot, Turkana, Marsabit, Samburu, Isiolo, Mandera, Wajir, Garissa, Tana River, Lam, Kilifi, Kwale, Taita, Taveta, and Narok. Definitely, if you look from the map, these areas are also difficult. So for some of you who are going to provide services, you really must be focused, rest on what you expect to deliver from those counties might actually experience some challenges.
Principal Secretary, Ministry of Energy, retired Major General Dr. Gordon Kihalangwa, says this is part of the government's efforts to achieve universal access to electricity by 2026 as per the Kenya National Electrification Strategy. Regina Manyara reporting for Prime Edition.
Away from energy matters to technology, where the Konza Technopolis Development Authority has announced plans to formally roll out phases 2 and 3 of the Konza Technopolis Development Master Plan. ICT Principal Secretary Jerome Ochieng says foreign and local investor appetite for the project has increased due to the designation of Konza Technopolis as a special economic zone.
Set on 400 acres of land, Phase 1 of the Konza Technopolis has attracted investors in the light industrial, housing, academia, agricultural research and commercial, among others. The government says Phase 1 of Konza Technopolis, which is more than 80% complete, has given way for a new round of investments in Phase 2.
Collaborations with very many international agencies. We are looking forward to having the research institute. We're also looking forward to having a vaccine center. There are quite a number of things that are both innovative and creative that will also be going on. We're looking at having the media center and all these kind of things that we need in a city environment.
Speaking during an investor conference, the government says there is a need to instill more confidence in major investors who are still deploying a wait-and-see attitude towards the long-term project.
I know people have been very impatient in terms of wondering what has been going on, but really, I want to emphasize the fact that we've really done some very, very good work, because we've spent most of our time working on the horizontal infrastructure. And the horizontal infrastructure in any building environment is key, and that has taken quite some time.
At Konza, we are providing you with a value proposition described by some people as a country where power goes off. At Konza, such will not be, because we are arguing the case, we are planning it well. We put systems in place that will ensure that you do not only get continuous energy, but you get it clean.
Currently, according to COTA, besides the horizontal infrastructure, the project has created about 17,000 jobs in high-skilled labor and other indirect job opportunities. It now has a 700 megavolt amperes power station and a wastewater reclamation facility. The Kenya Advanced Institute of Science and Technology, KAIST, a conference center and residential units are among the vertical infrastructure at different stages of construction in the Technopolis.
And the next step is to see now the private sector investment, and we are very excited to see what's happening, the progress on the uptake of the investment. Now the next step is to see actually the investment by the private sector.
COTTA is calling on investors to look to the new phases 2 and 3, which will see the establishment of a digital media city, smart vaccine manufacturing initiative, a science and technology park in partnership with the Ministry of Education, and Dubai Multi Commodity Center Corporation. Alan Oko, Prime Edition.
Quite some encouraging news there coming out of Konza, and you just need to go to Konza just for you to realize how much development is taking place at the Technopolis. Well, private sector players have backed the government's move to ban importation of used trucks, buses and prime movers. The directive in the National Automotive Policy seeks to protect and promote local assemblers. The Kenya Private Sector Alliance says the intervention will build the market for local products while lowering the cost of doing business for the global competitiveness of Kenya's products and services.
2021, Kenya's total assembly volume was at 11,000 units. The local industry is barely utilizing 30% of its capacity, which is 34,000 units per annum on one shift. KEPSA says the national automotive policy will ensure increased volumes of vehicles produced locally, as well as attract investments into the automotive industry. The association says that the local assembly will also reduce the cost of local business while promoting global competitiveness of the nation's products and services. According to the CEO, the automotive industry has the capacity to greatly contribute to the manufacturing sector's growth, as the government has set a target to propel its share of the GDP from the current 9.2% to 15% by 2022 as a part of the Big Four agenda. The KEPSA CEO said that the automotive industry had a great potential for creating more jobs than the importation of vehicles used. The KEPSA CEO said that the automotive industry had a great potential for creating more jobs than the importation of used vehicles. She said that for every job in the assembly plants, the industry could create between 5 to 11 jobs in the value chain. The policy that takes effect on 1st of July reads that all types of used passenger minibuses used in the country's famous matatu industry will not be allowed to be imported. Used minibuses common with corporates, large buses, single articulated and bi-articulated buses, and double-decker buses will also not be allowed. Reporting for Prime Edition, I am Nduta Mukami.
And the tug of war between second-hand truck importers as well as the local vehicle assemblers continue. And the question is, who is going to blink first? We'll keep on following up on that story. My name is O'Brien Kimani. Thank you very much. You have been watching Business News. And of course, coming up next is a short break. And thereafter, Tom Boyer will be coming up next with Sports News. Have a good night.
I'd like to officially welcome you to the coolest club in the 254. In other words, this is the best way to wake up every single morning.
Wake me up before you go, go. Don't leave me hanging on like a yo-yo. Wake me up before you go, go. I don't want to...
Top sports attractions on KBC Channel 1. In July, Kenya Morans face off against the DRC, Egypt and Senegal in the FIBA Basketball World Cup African Qualifiers in Alexandria, Egypt from 1st to 3rd of July 2022. Also in July, Kenya plays South Africa in Rugby League Test matches in Nairobi with a return fixture set for October. Still in July, watch the World Athletic Championships from 15th to 24th July live from Oregon, USA as Kenyan athletes seek glory. Followed by the 22nd Commonwealth Games from 28th July to 8th August live from Birmingham, England. In August, join our coverage of the World Athletics Under-20 Championships from the 1st to 6th of August 2022 from Cali, Colombia. Then, in November, catch the World Half Marathon Championships on 13th November from Yangzhou, China. Now that's what sets us apart as KBC Channel 1, your true sports partner.
Welcome back. Let's now get sporty, and I'm sitting in for Richard Munga. The Ministry of Sports has been urged to hold more sporting activities in the country as a way of promoting peace as the country builds up to the electioneering period. Speaking during the launch of the Amani Torch Run, Deputy Inspector General of Police Edward Bogwa said sports is the best tool to engage youth and keep them away from social vices. Here is that report.
Speaking at the Amani Torch Run held at the Moi International Sports Center, Kasarani, Deputy Inspector General of Police Edward Bogwa said youths who can be easily swayed by political leaders need to be engaged, especially during the current electioneering period.
The youth are the most affected by the elections because some of the politicians want to use the youth in order to disrupt other aspirants of the elections. And if the youth can say no, this will not happen.
He said sporting activities will create unity among the youth and promote peace in the community.
It is the youth because most of them are not employed. Most of them are very vulnerable. If they are given something small, they can be used to light fire in our country, which we don't want to happen. We want peace.
Amani Torch Run was organized by Special Olympics Kenya, and the National Police Service was aimed at promoting peace as the country builds up to the August general elections. National Cohesion and Integration Commission Chairperson Reverend Dr. Samuel Kobia urged the youths in the country not to be swayed by political leaders.
It is even more inspiring that our torch carriers are none other than our Special Olympics athletes who represent a segment of society that Kenya needs to listen most to.
The run will traverse all 47 counties in the country and conclude before the August general elections. For Prime Edition Sports, I'm Daniel Mwendo.
Now, some sports analysts refer to rugby as the rough game that's played by gentlemen. National Rugby 15-a-side team Simbas will leave the country tomorrow in the morning for France to take part in the Rugby World Cup African qualifiers set to be held between the 1st and the 10th of next month in Paris. The team coached by Paul Odera will begin their campaign against Uganda this Saturday. The team received a 10 million shilling sponsorship boost today from Taita Sisal Estate. Kenya Rugby Union Chair Oduor Gangla said that sponsorship will boost the morale of the players who have been in intense preparations over the past 2 years for the assignment. He said that their main goal is to secure Kenya's first ever qualification to the 15 Rugby World Cup. Now, the winner of the tournament earns direct qualification to next year's Rugby World Cup. Nigerian sprinter Blessing Okagbare has been handed an extra one-year ban for additional doping violations to add to her existing 10-year suspension. As a result of Okagbare's additional ban, Nigeria has lost its potential qualification place in the women's 4x100 relay in July's World Championships in Oregon.
In February, the three-year-old Blessing Okagbare was banned for multiple breaches of anti-doping rules. She was suspended during 2021 Tokyo Olympic after failing a drug test. Okagbare, the 2008 Olympic long jump silver medalist, was a medal contender for women's 100 meters in Tokyo last year and won her heat in 11.05 seconds. But she was ruled out of the semifinals after she tested positive of human growth hormone following an out competition test on 19th July.
And Okagbare is starting to forge away. Has she done it again here? Okagbare surprises everybody.
As a result, Okagbare's additional ban, Nigeria has lost its potential qualification place in the women's 4x100 meters relay in July's World Championship. For Sports News, I'm Kingori Mwangi.
Britain's Andy Murray maintained his record of never losing in the first round of Wimbledon with an encouraging win over Australia's James Duckworth, while British number one Emma Raducanu had a winning start to her first Wimbledon as a Grand Slam champion.
Andy Murray overcame Australia's James Duckworth in the Wimbledon opener to maintain his record of never losing the first round. After a slow start, the former world number one, now ranked 52nd, won 4-6, 6-3, 6-2 and 6-4 under the floodlight on the center court. The 35-year-old Scot will now face American John Isner, seeded 20th in the second round on Wednesday. Meanwhile, British number one Emma Raducanu had a winning start to her first Wimbledon as the Grand Slam champion. The 19-year-old overcame a nervous start on her centre court debut to beat Alison Van 6-4, 6-4 on the first and second set. Backed by an enthusiastic home crowd, the US Open champion showed no sign of side injury that hurt her build-up. She'll face Caroline Garcia next after France former world number 4 edge British wildcard Lily Miyazaki.
Well, that's all we had time for. Remember that right after this live broadcast, we have your show, Kenya Decides Tonight, being hosted by one of my colleagues. So there you are on stage, all ready to go. JJ Kioria with a panel pointing towards where we are, because they're right across the street, I think. So I want to thank you on behalf of the Prime Edition team, including Lensa Odingo, who I forgot to mention earlier on. Thank you so much for watching. My name is Tom Boyer. Good night from Nairobi, Kenya.